Well, good morning and welcome to worship here at FirstSF. We're so glad that we have people able to join us in our sanctuary, and then I know others who are able to join us online, and we are just so thankful that however you're worshiping with us today, that you've chosen to spend this morning with us worshiping our Lord and Savior. We're so thankful for this day that God has given us to be able to be glad and rejoice in it. It's been such a great season here at our church, even as we've kind of been trying to come through meeting again and doing ministries again. We've had new people coming each week to join us in person. So if you happen to be a first-time visitor, or maybe it's your first time in a long time, just know that we're really happy that you're here. If there's any ways that we can be praying for you, ways that we can be helping you get connected to our church, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. We've got different ways that you can connect to us online so that we can just help you in that. We want to be able to meet with you, pray with you, minister to you in any way that we can. And we've been so thankful over the last couple of weeks to celebrate some baptisms together as a church. If you're ever interested in baptism, just want to know more about why we baptize or what that means, please let us know. Ask us questions about that. But today, we won't have baptisms, but we will get to celebrate the Lord's Supper together. And so hopefully if you're here in person, you were able to pick up your elements on the way in. If you weren't, there should be an opportunity for you to go and grab those at some point before we observe that at the end of the service. But such a special way to be able to worship God together. And just as we come to worship, I want to just kind of draw our attention in and our focus of our minds in by reading from 1 Chronicles chapter 16. This is a song of David giving thanks to the Lord. David says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all his wondrous works. Glory in his name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice." He goes on to say later in the chapter, "Sing to the Lord all the earth. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and he is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and joy are in his place. Would you pray with me? Father, we come to praise you because you alone are worthy to be praised. God, we come to rejoice in you because you are our joy. Lord, we thank you for this day that you've given us. We thank you for the opportunity to worship together. Thank you for technology and the way that we're able to connect with people that can't be here in our sanctuary with us, but thank you for bringing us who are here together. Thank you for uniting us by your Spirit that we might praise you as your people. God, I pray that in these moments that we dedicate to you for corporate worship, God, as we sing, as we pray, as we study your word together, God, would you help us to do it with a focus on you? Would you help us to block out distractions of what's going on around us or what's going on after this? And God, help us just to focus our minds and our hearts on giving you the praise that only you deserve, on glorifying you, on lifting up your name, because you are great, greatly to be praised, Father. We sing your praises this morning. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Church family, will you stand with us? You know, as you do, let me ask you a question. Do you remember the good things or the bad things more readily? Nobody's talking. That's probably great. So often we forget how good God is to us. And the chorus of the song says, Lord, you found me. Say that after me. Lord, you found me.
Lord, you found me.
You healed me.
You
called me from the grave. Sometimes we just need to declare what God has done for us, and that's what we want to do this morning as Amy and the team leads us. Amen. You can be seated. We're going to hear a testimony this morning and hear about a special opportunity of something God's doing here in the Bay Area.
Good morning. Good morning. This morning we're highlighting one of our local partners called Foster the Bay as we conclude the month of May, which is Foster Care Awareness Month. Frank and I are your church advocates for Foster the Bay, which is a coalition of Bay Area churches committed to providing a safe and loving home for every child in foster care in the Bay Area. What that means for us is stepping into broken systems that include homelessness, addiction, human trafficking, imprisonment. I know personally, having been a foster child myself, that many foster kids experience some form of trauma as well as abuse. Most are at high risk of being trapped in these broken systems. As of January 1st, 2021, this year, there were 723 children in the foster care system in San Francisco, the majority of whom were unable to stay in the city due to a lack of enough homes. They not only experience the trauma of being separated from their families, but also feel isolated from being sent away from their communities and schools. Isaiah 1:17 says, "Learn to do right, seek justice, defend the oppressed, take up the cause of the fatherless, plead the case of the widow." The good news is that every one of these children is at the center of our Heavenly Father's heart, and He desires to use us to be a source of healing for them and their families. Any one of us who is willing to say yes to being involved in this ministry will be a part of God's plan to restore foster kids to wholeness and to help repair the breaches created by the brokenness in their lives. Every amount of compassion shown matters, and every act of kindness makes a difference. None are too small. We ask you to pray about becoming involved, whether it is being a foster family or parent, or being a part of a support team that surrounds the family with compassion and practical helps. You can also be a part of the church advocate team, which casts the foster care vision for our church, as well as coordinates connecting support friends with foster families, which are also known as resource families. Of course, above all, your prayers are an essential way to be involved in the work that God wants to do with our church ministry. We are grateful for those who have already said yes to being involved and have gone or are going through the process of being trained and approved. At the end of this morning's service, we'll be up front here to answer any questions. If you're watching online, you can send an email to Sam at samantha@firstsf.com. Now Samantha will pray for us.
Let's pray. Faithful Father, we thank you that you care for the vulnerable and that you call us to love and care for them too. Thank you for ministries like Foster the Bay who desire to gather church communities to rise up and care well for children who need a safe space. Lord, we pray for the children and families who are in these situations, who need people to walk alongside them as they work to become healthy families. We pray that each family would encounter you as their loving Father and that they would desire to know you and love you. We pray for the many children in foster care, that you provide them with safe homes and people who care for them as they are going through so much. Lord, we also pray for our church community, that you would begin stirring in each of our hearts how we can be involved and be a part of the solution in helping families and children thrive and to know just how much you love them. Lord, create in us a heart that is giving and sacrificial and one that will reflect you. Lord, we ask that you grow our compassion to care for those around us well. And thank you for how you are already working in so many families and through many churches across the Bay Area. Amen.
Amen. invite you guys to stand again. If you'd like, if you need to sit, that's fine too.
Every day in your hands, you were there before time began. Sovereign one, I rest in your plan. From the dust to the dawn, you were there, your promise is strong. I will trust with all that I am.
So Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
not a God who just uses us for your own pleasure, Lord. Even though you could, you reached out to us, God, with love. Lord, you chose to come and become a man, live as a human. You suffered and died in our place. Lord, you made a way for us to come to you. And Lord, this morning, no matter what we are facing, Lord, we know that you have made a way for us. Lord, this morning we worship you because you are God. We worship you because of your great sacrifice. We worship you, God, because you are the way maker. Lord, you are the God who goes before your people and leads them. Lord, you are the God who leads us beside still waters. You're the God who restores our soul. And Lord, we worship you this morning. Thank you.
Pray with me. Father, as we come to your word, would you help us just to continue in this time of worship? Would you help us to continue to see you more clearly, who you are, and God, seeing not only how you have made a way of salvation, but you are making a way in each of us who believed in you to be able to follow you and to live for your glory, Father. I pray that your spirit would speak to us this morning through your word. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. You can be seated. You know, when it comes to the Christian life, I think that there's really two errors that people often fall into. There's one error that as people try to live the Christian life, they seem to really kind of think that they need to work really hard to keep their salvation or to kind of save themselves, if you will. Like this mindset usually says, well, I know God has saved me by grace. Like I know forgiveness comes as a gift from God. But now that I've been saved, now that I've been forgiven, living in this salvation, that's something I've got to try really hard at, something I've got to kind of do in my own good works. You know, maybe a few weeks ago we were talking about the different components to salvation, if you could remember that, back when we first started the book of Philippians. And we were talking about that there's this phrase called justification. And that's the time when you are forgiven of your sins. You are freed from the penalty of sin, if you will. God forgives you, and it's a gift. It's by grace. But then we talked about that there's this process of sanctification, that you are being freed from the power of sin in your life, that you're growing to look more like Christ. And I think that this first error that people fall into would say, yes, justification, that's a work of God, but sanctification, that's my work. I'm the one who has to kind of carry out this process of growing to look more like Jesus. But then there's this kind of other extreme, this other error that people will often fall into. It's kind of on the other side of the road, the other ditch, if you will, that if some people believe they've got to work really hard to kind of keep their salvation and sanctify themselves, the other group kind of says, well, you know what? Salvation is a gift from God. God has saved me by his grace. God says in his word that he is going to keep me. Jesus said nothing's going to snatch me out of his hand. And so I don't really need to like kind of work too hard in this Christian life. Like this is all a work of God from start to finish. This kind of mindset really wants to guard against maybe legalism or falling into religion. They'll say, well, it's not about religion, it's about a relationship. And relationships should kind of be easy. I should just be able to walk with God. Maybe this mindset would kind of justify their way of thinking by saying, you know what, God's grace is so great to cover all my sins. God's mercies are new every morning. No matter what I do, God's always going to forgive me. He's already forgiven me. And it can be so easy as we live the Christian life to really fall into either one of these errors. Just in our day-to-day walk, I think it's really easy. You know, the first error, I think, kind of really does tend to fall into the mindset of legalism. Legalism is the idea that by my good works, by my obedience to God, by my doing good things, that I will keep or I will obtain God's blessing and his love. It's this idea that the more I work, the more God will love me, or that God will keep loving me. And this first error kind of falls into that. But then there's the other error that really falls into what you might call licentiousness. It's really like a license to sin. It's like this idea that because God has given me by his grace, I can just kind of live however I want. And the reason it's really tricky is because what we tend to do is we tend to fight one error with the other. Have you ever noticed that? Like some people, they grow up in like a religious household or a very strict household, and they see some of the failures in that, and they say, I don't want to be one of those legalistic people. And so what do? They often kind of throw out a lot of the rules. And they say, well, I just need to kind of enjoy what God's done for me, enjoy this relationship that I have with him. Or other people, they will kind of see, maybe they call it like easy believism or cheap grace. They'll say, well, these people are just kind of however they're wanting to. They're just abusing God's grace. And so they kind of start to set up more rules and give kind of more restrictions that you need to follow. And it's very misguided of us to try to fix one error with another error, as if that's the solution. What we need, I think, is we need a better way. We need a better way for living the Christian life than falling into either one of these errors. And that's why I'm so thankful for our text this morning. Philippians chapter 2, specifically 12 and 13, which we'll see, but even continuing on, shows us the better way. It really shows us the better way of thinking about the Christian life. It really gives us, I think, kind of a prescription for if we will keep this in our minds, it will actually keep us balanced in our approach of the Christian life, keeping us from really falling into either side of these errors. But not only that, our text today not only shows us how we can live the Christian life, but why we are called to live this life. Not just how we're supposed to do it, but why. Like you living the Christian life is not just about you kind of holding on to your salvation or just making it to heaven one day. It's much greater than that. God has a great purpose in saving you. God has a great purpose in you living out this life. And our text reveals that to us today. But as we work out our salvation, as we work out what God is working in us, we are actually shining as lights in a dark world. We are living for his glory. So if you have a Bible, we're going to be in Philippians chapter 2. We're going to be in verses 12 through 18. And what I want to do is I want to kind of read our passage for us this morning, and then we'll walk back through it together and see what is laid out for us in these verses. So Paul writes to the church in Philippi chapter 2, starting in verse 12, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only is in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Do all things without grumbling or disputing, that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain. Even if I am to be poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrificial offering of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all. Likewise, you also should be glad and rejoice with me." Now, I want you to notice this morning in verse 12, our passage begins with a therefore. Therefore is really important for you as you read your Bible to always kind of see these connecting words. And therefore is a really important connecting word because it says what has just been told to us is really the foundation for what I'm about to say. Like I'm drawing a conclusion based on what I've just said. And so Paul says therefore, which lets us know what we read in verses 12 through 18 are really building upon. Are they a conclusion of what has just been said? And it's not only what's just been said in the kind of immediate verses right before that we saw last week, but as we talked about last week, last week's passage was actually building upon what Paul had said at the end of chapter 1, which we looked at 2 weeks ago. And so just to remind you, what we've kind of said for the last couple of weeks is that Paul, at this point in the letter, has turned to the Philippians. And by kind of us receiving the letter today, has turned to us and said, here's one thing you need to do. You, as God's people, you need to live as those who have been made worthy by the good news of Jesus. You need to live as those who have been made worthy of the gospel, live as unified citizens of God's kingdom. And what Paul's doing in this section is continuing to build on that idea. And so as we've gone over the last couple of weeks, we've talked about we as a church need to stand together and strive together. And we've talked about the need for unity and humility and following Christ's example. What Paul says here, as he talks about us working out our salvation and shining as lights, is just continuing to clarify what he means by that. It's like Paul's got a screwdriver, and he's kind of continually working this idea into our minds. that you are to live as those who have been made worthy of the gospel. Live as God's people, his citizens of his kingdom. And what does that look like? Well, I hope this morning it only serves to further clarify it in our mind. And what I'd like to do is, before we kind of dissect this passage or start to look at it more in depth, is to kind of give you my big picture kind of summary of these verses. If I was to kind of take what we see in these verses and give it to you in one sentence so that you could kind of think about it, and we'll unpack it together this morning, it would be this: that God empowers believers to work out their salvation for his glory and for their joy. But I think we see in this passage, if I was just to kind of summarize it in one sentence for us to kind of just think about, and we're going to unpack it as we go, is just to consider the fact that God empowers believers, those who have trusted in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, to work out their salvation for his glory and for their joy. So what I want to do is I want us to kind of walk through this passage, and I want to do it in kind of different sections that would almost unpack that statement for us this morning. And so I'll give you kind of four ways that you could consider this passage, four components, if you will, that we'll think about. The first one is for us to consider the process. There's a process that we are called to here, and that's what I want us to first see. What we see in that big idea is that we are to work out our salvation as believers in Jesus, and it is a process. So look with me at verse 12. Paul says, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling." So there is a process that we are called to in this passage. The process is to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. Now, Paul actually begins this call to this process with a great encouragement. Do you notice he calls the Philippian believers his beloved? And he says, you've been obeying in this. Now just continue to walk in it. Continue to work it out. It's like he wants to come alongside of them first and encourage them in what they've been doing. This is probably something that I, as a pastor and a preacher, need to improve upon, is continual encouragement. Sometimes it might feel like we just come together each week and I just give you, here's more things for you to believe and do. And sometimes we need to stop and be encouraged. Paul's not saying you have doing this. He says, you have obeyed. You obeyed when I was there with you in your presence. Now in your absence, in my absence to you, would you continue to obey? Would you continue to live this out? That's a really helpful perspective, I think, for us to have. That this process of working out our salvation, this process of following Jesus, it's a lifelong journey. It's one that we are always needing to continue on. And sometimes, you know, we look back, maybe we say, well, this past week I really did a bad job, and we get discouraged, and we don't have the fight in us to continue in this coming week. Like we say, man, I've just been failing a lot. You feel kind of dejected, and so you don't continue in this process. Or sometimes we look at our lives, we think, wow, I'm really doing well here. I've been reading my Bible, I've been doing all these things that God tells me to do, and we start to kind of not continue in the process as we should. We should see this as a journey, lifelong obedience. Eugene Peterson calls this long obedience in the same direction. Like it's a journey that we take that is of discipleship, of growing to look more like Jesus. He says, you have obeyed, be encouraged, but continue in this process. Continue to work out your salvation. You say, well, Pastor Ben, what does that mean, to work out your salvation? Because if you've read the Bible, even if you just read from Paul, who's the same author of this letter as other letters, that might sound like a weird phrase to you. You might say, well, I thought salvation was a gift from God. I thought we were saved by grace, not by works. What does he mean that we have to work out our salvation if we're not saved by our works? I mean, just one chapter back at the beginning of this letter, in chapter 1, verse 6, this is what Paul said. And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Christ Jesus. So it sounds like there, God is doing a work. He began a good work, and now God is going to continue this work until the end. So you say, well, what is this call for us to work out our salvation? Well, I think it's really important for you to notice that Paul does not call you to work for your salvation. He calls you to work out your salvation. That's a really big difference. That's an important preposition. He says, don't work for your salvation. Salvation has been given to you. God has begun this work in you. Salvation from beginning to end, it is a work of God. But you now must work out your salvation. It's really what we've been saying for the last couple of weeks. Hopefully what we say consistently each time we come back to God's word. And that is, we don't work to make ourselves worthy of the gospel. We work as people who have been made worthy of the gospel. We don't try to earn God's love. We recognize that God has freely loved us, that while we were sinners, Christ died for us, and now we live in that love. We recognize that we're not trying to get a new identity, but God has given us a new identity. He has united us to Christ, and now we are called to walk in this, to live in this. And now Paul is clarifying here that to do this is going to require work. To live in this, to walk in this, is not always going to be an easy process. It is going to require work, that you are to work out your salvation, that you are called to strive, to toil, to bring about this process of sanctification. And you're saying, well, what does it look like to work out your salvation? Well, it's what he's already said, right? He says, you've been obeying, so continue in that. To work out your salvation is to continue in obedience to God. It's to follow Jesus' example. It's to do the things that would bring glory to God. I think sometimes we try to overcomplicate things. We say, well, I don't know what it means to work out my salvation. But yes, we do. It's to follow what God has told us to do. It's to live as he has called us to live. We are to live as people who have been saved, like a child who has been adopted into a family. Positionally, you have changed. You are now part of the family. Now live like it. Live as one of God's children. But not only does he call us to obedience, but he actually gives us a description of what this obedience is to look like. Do you see in verse 14? He says, do all things without grumbling or disputing. Now, if you're just reading, you might think that sounds kind of just like random, like it's off the wall. Like he's telling us to work out your salvation, and the next thing he says is do all things, everything you do in the Christian life. Everything you do as you strive to do it in obedience to God, for the glory of God, do it without grumbling or disputing. And you might think that sounds kind of random, but that's really a central part of our working out our salvation. That we're not only supposed to obey, but we're supposed to do it with the right attitude. I mean, what we've seen throughout this letter is that the gospel not only saves us, but it changes us. It should change our perspective, and with a new perspective comes a new attitude. That you are supposed to walk in obedience without grumbling or without disputing. I think the Israelites of the Old Testament are a good example that you could receive the gracious work of God in your life and still grumble and complain. And doesn't that still happen to us today? I mean, have you ever met somebody who goes to church, who does the Christian things, and they just never seem happy about it? Like, don't start looking around the room or pointing at people. But, I mean, I tell you, I've been in church all my life, and I've seen these people in every church you go to. There's always somebody that they only seem to come to church just so they can complain about church. Like, they only serve in ministry just so they can let you know how hard it is, what a sacrifice it is for them to serve in that ministry. Paul says what stands at the mark of a Christian is not just obedience, doing what God has called you to do, but doing it with the right attitude. I mean, what is the central theme of this whole letter? It's to rejoice in the Lord. What's the opposite of rejoicing? It's grumbling. It's disputing. It's this complaining. Paul's saying, don't just seek to work out your salvation by being obedient, but do it with a changed heart, a changed mindset, a new attitude. That you are now enjoying this process. So what does it mean to work out your salvation? It means to live in obedience to God, to follow what he has called you to do, to live for his glory, and to do it with the right mindset, right attitude. And perhaps one more phrase that he gives us here that would be helpful for us to consider in this process. He says in the beginning of verse 16, holding fast to the word of life. The word of life being the message of the gospel. He says, what does it look like for you to work out your salvation? It's for you to be obedient. It's for you to hold fast to the gospel, for you to walk in the gospel. So kind of standing in contrast with complaining or disputing or grumbling is this idea of holding fast to the gospel. Maybe we could phrase it like this: the church should spend a lot less time complaining and a lot more time proclaiming. We should have a proper attitude where we're not kind of complaining about all the things that God has called us to do, but our minds have been so transformed by the gospel that we are now enjoying it. We are rejoicing in it, and we are proclaiming it, holding fast the truth. So this is the process that we are called to. It's to work out, to live out our salvation, to bring about this process of sanctification in our lives. But that brings me back to my kind of original question, or the two errors that we fall into, which is, how does this process actually take place? Is it just by our hard work? Is it by us just being really determined, self-controlled? We're going to work harder than others, people? Is it going to be something that God does in us, through us, without our work at all? Well, that's where we come next to the power. So Paul calls us to a process. He says, here's what you're supposed to do in working out your salvation. But then he speaks about the power to actually carry out this process. Look at verse 13. For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. So the power for living the Christian life is actually coming from God. The power for you to fight against sin. The power for you to resist temptation, the power for you to obey, do the things that God has called you to do for his glory is actually going to come from God. And notice, it's not like you and God working side by side, like you're a tag team, right? And you say, well, I'm going to work hard, and when I just can't do it anymore, that's when God comes in and helps me out. You know, I'm going to do my part, and God's going to do his part, and that's how I'm going to carry out this process. No, it's actually God doing the work first that then produces your work. It's not like you and God working side by side. It's like God's doing all the work in you that then produces your work. So make no mistake, living the Christian life is about working hard. Like, you're not just going to fight your sin passively. You're not just going to wake up one morning and be Christ-like. That's going to take work. That this journey that we are called to, this obedience that we are called to, it does take work, but we have to get the mindset right. It is not us working on our own power and our own strength by us just trying harder. It is actually God working in us, empowering us to do the work. That's actually how Paul, I think, clarifies what he says earlier in chapter 1, verse 6. What we read earlier, it says, God began a good work in you and he's going to carry it on to completion until the end. That's still true, but now Paul is just clarifying, how is God going to carry on this work? It's not just going to be you laying back and him carrying you along. God began a good work in you, and he's going to continue this good work in you by empowering you as a believer to work. That's God's process here. God empowering you to live in the way that he has called you to live. Now, in my kind of main statement, my one-sentence summary, I said, God's grace is what empowers the believer to work out your salvation. And you say, well, where do you see that in the text? Well, one, I think we've just seen the example of what Jesus has done. This graciousness of God towards us that is going to therefore lead us to work out our salvation. And it's certainly a work of the Holy Spirit who indwells us. But the reason I say it's God's grace is because of what Paul says in another letter. As he writes to the church in Corinth, Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 10, but by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace towards me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Do you see that? Paul says, I worked harder than anyone else, but the work that I did was actually the grace of God working in me. And that will happen when we can honestly say, it's by the grace of God that I am what I am. I think some of us might say that, but most of us would probably think, well, it's the grace of God and my working hard. You know, I got where I am today by the grace of God and my good deeds, by the grace of God and my staying up late to study, or my staying up late to get that extra work in, or me putting in the extra effort. But Paul would honestly say, it's by the grace of God that I'm an apostle. I'm the chief of all sinners, the least of all the apostles, but it's only by the grace of God that I am what I am. And that's what allows the grace of God to then empower him. You see, what we need is we need to constantly bring our minds back to the good news of Jesus, to the grace of God. That is the only way we are who we are. And as we continually bring our focus back to God's grace, our faith will grow. And that's when we are empowered by God's grace to live according to the way that he has called us to live, to obey in the way that he has called us to obey. This is actually something I said earlier in week one as we saw Philippians 1:6. And just to kind of bring it back to your memory, I would say it again. God's sovereignty and salvation does not give us an excuse to be passive or lazy. Rather, it gives us confidence to work out what he is working in us. God's sovereignty, his kind of complete control of salvation, that he began a good work in us and he will carry it to completion, does not mean we just lay back and do nothing. It just gives us confidence to work, confidence to carry out what he is doing in us. And do you notice that's actually why Paul says you should do it with fear and trembling? I didn't mention that earlier, but Paul says this process, working out your salvation, you should do it with fear and trembling. And a lot of people would read that and they might think, well, what am I afraid of? What am I trembling at? Am I afraid that maybe I'll lose my salvation? Am I afraid that maybe I'll mess up, maybe that I'll fail in this whole process of working out my salvation, that I'll make God mad, so I should do it with fear and trembling? But do you notice in verse 13, he says, you do it with fear and trembling for, because it is God working in you. Actually, that fear and trembling is a respect and an awe that God's Spirit indwells me, that God is empowering me, so I'm not going to take this process lightly. I am going to live it out in a way that is honoring to God and what he is doing in me. I'm going to do this with fear and trembling, not afraid that I might fail, but with respect, with awe, with the fear of God in me because he is empowering me to work. And Paul says he's doing this for a purpose. There's this process that we are called to work out our salvation that God's going to empower you for, and it's for a great purpose. Make no mistake, God is not just saving you just so you can get to heaven. God is not doing this all these things in your life, empowering you to work just so you'll be a good person, so you'll be nice to other people. God is doing it for an even greater purpose. He says in verse 13, "For it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure." That means God empowers our will. He empowers our desires. And he empowers our work, our doing. God empowers it all. He gives us the desires and the doing, the work, to work for a specific purpose, for his good pleasure. Some translations will say, for his good purpose. God is doing all this for a plan that he has, for what will bring him pleasure, for what will bring him fulfillment in his purpose. And what is God's purpose is all about? What is God's great purpose for all things? It is to bring glory to him. That's why God does all things that he does. That is the way God is working throughout all of history, throughout all of creation, to bring him glory. That's what we just saw last week at the end of the passage about Jesus Christ and what he did, the way he humbled himself. Paul says at the end of that passage in verses 10 and 11, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. God is doing all things, including empowering you to work out your salvation for his glory. All of creation, all earthly beings, spiritual beings, will one day fully glorify God, and that's his great purpose, and that's why he is doing this in you. He's empowering you to work out your salvation, not just so that you'll be a good person or you'll make it to heaven, but to glorify him. That's what Paul describes later on in verse 15 about why we should not grumble or complain. He says in verse 15, that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish in the midst of a crooked, twisted generation among whom you shine as lights in the world. You know, I kind of alluded to earlier that the Israelites were a good example that you can see God's gracious work, his power in your life, and still grumble and complain. And Paul's language here is actually really clearly drawing on this Old Testament example of the people of God. The nation of Israel is supposed to be like a light unto the nations. They were supposed to reveal God's glory through their actions. But they failed. I mean, they could not because they had not yet received God's Spirit within them. Because they had not received that finished work of Jesus, they could not live for his glory as they were created to do. They were not able to fully live as the children of God. In fact, that's what Paul quotes here about living as lights in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation. That's a kind of a direct quote from Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 5. God speaking about the people of Israel says they have dealt corruptly with him. Or Moses speaking about the way they deal with God. They are no longer his children because they are blemished. They are a crooked and twisted generation. You see there, he says, the people that were supposed to be my children were living as the world. And so Paul says here, you are supposed to live different. You're supposed to obey God with the right attitude, and when you do that, it will bring glory to God as you shine like a light. That's what he means when he says that you'll shine like a light amongst this twisted and crooked generation, that you'll look different than the world. The language here is actually shining like a star, like the stars that light up the night sky. That's what Christians are called to be. When we were in high school, Alana had a little karaoke machine. We as friends would get together and we would like sing silly songs and do karaoke together. I don't know if it was before or after each song, but it would put up this little message, this little encouragement. It would tell you, be the star you are. That's the way that they encourage you to really sing your heart out in karaoke. That's what Paul's calling us to here. Be the star that you are. Shine as a light in the world. You have to live different from the world. And this is a difficult balance that we as Christians are going to have to walk. We've talked about in the last couple of weeks, really throughout this letter, that we are called to love all people. We must love people who don't believe like we do, who don't follow Jesus like we do. But in the midst of our loving them, we still have to live different than them. We still have to be set apart from them. That's how you shine as a light in the dark world. And it's not always going to be easy. I know in your workplace, I know at your school, wherever you find yourself, it won't always be easy to stand out, to shine like a light, but it is for God's glory. Not only that you would glorify him in your own life, but that other people might even glorify him. Isn't that what Jesus said whenever he called us to be lights in the world? He says in the same way, Matthew 5:16, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. You see this? You working out your salvation, you fighting against sin, you seeking to obey God. God's going to empower that. He's going to do it for a purpose. It's for his glory, for you to shine like a light in the world. But it's not only for his glory, it is also for your joy. That's the last component that we'll see in this passage. I'll call it the product. What is the product? What is the kind of outworking of this process? It's done for a purpose, and we could say the product is the glory of God. That's why we do what we do in terms of working out our salvation. But what Paul says here is that it actually produces something. That the end of this working out of our salvation, it actually works in us joy that we did not have before. Verse 16, Paul calls them to hold fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ Jesus, he says, that I might know that I did not run or labor in vain. Paul's talking about here like he is running a race or he's working as someone in the field. And he wants them to continue on so that he knows that in the day, at the end of days, when Jesus Christ returns, that he might be able to rejoice, that it was not in vain, it was for their faith, it was for their joy. But Paul says, not only I'm going to rejoice in that last day, but I'm rejoicing even right now. You see what he says in verse 17? Even if I'm to be poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrificial offering of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all. The drink offering in the sacrificial system was kind of like an extra. Like you would have the food offering burning on the altar, meat, sometimes other food. And as it was burning on the altar, you would take a bit of wine and you would pour it. If you can imagine, a hot altar with liquid being poured onto it would really just vaporize the liquid and send it up as steam. That's what the drink offering was. It was meant to just kind of be a picture of prayers going up to God, that God would receive the sacrifice. It wasn't the main offering. Paul says, your faith, you're living for God, you're surrendering to him, that's like the main offering. Even if my life is poured out as a drink offering, a small part of what you are doing. Paul speaks of later in his letter to Timothy, of being poured out as a drink offering in a word about his impending death. He says, even if I am to die and my life is just going to be consumed like a vapor, I am going to rejoice because I know it was doing something in you. I'm going to rejoice and be glad. And he says in verse 18, likewise, you also should be glad and rejoice with me. The Philippians are offering a sacrifice to faith. Like sacrifices, like living sacrifices, they are offering their bodies. And he says, in that, you should rejoice with me. You see, on the far side of us working out our salvation is a greater joy than you could ever imagine. What I want you to know this morning is God is not opposed to your joy. Sometimes we think that God is just about setting up rules, calling us to obey, just to keep some joy from us. So many times we think we know what's going to bring us joy. But God is much more for your joy than you are. The Bible says that in his presence is the fullness of joy. He calls you to obey. He calls you to work out your salvation. He empowers you to do it all so that you might be able to rejoice in all circumstances. So many times we don't want to surrender things to God because we think they bring us joy, and we don't know that God is actually working for our much greater joy. We're like kids in a sandbox, just content to play there when God is inviting us to a vacation at the beach. He's saying there's so much more joy for you to have if you'll just surrender to me. If you'll just bring your life as a sacrifice of faith to me. Paul is saying here that on the other side of us working out our salvation, in the midst of it, there will be joy. And as we grow in it, there's this joy that would look at life and say, even if I am to die, to live is Christ, to die is gain. That in the midst of everything that I face, every trial in life, I will rejoice. Because I know that it's God working for my joy, working for my good and for his glory. And maybe you're here today and you've never really believed that before. You've never really believed that God is for your joy. You've never really believed that if you would just surrender to him, God would lead you into an everlasting joy greater than you could ever imagine. Today, I just want to invite you to consider, would you believe that today? Look to Jesus, who we saw last week, humbled himself much more than we will ever humble ourselves. Who lived in an obedient way that we will never live, who died in our place for God's glory and for his joy and for our joy. And you look to Jesus' example and you would see that on the other side of surrendering your life to God, on the other side of you sacrificing, of you making yourself available to him, that he will give you great joy. In just a moment, we're going to take the Lord's Supper together. And if you're here today and you've never trusted in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you never really believed that, I would say you don't need to take the Lord's Supper with us. Instead, you need to just maybe spend a few moments in prayer and just consider, what is preventing you? What is keeping you from surrendering to God? What is holding you back from that sacrifice of faith? Would you ask God to work in your heart that you might trust in Jesus today? But if you are here today and you've trusted in Jesus, as we take the Lord's Supper in just a moment, would you consider this process that he is calling you to? Would you consider his grace working in your life? Would you remember Jesus' sacrifice so that you might then lay down your life as a living sacrifice for God's glory and for your joy? Would you just enter into a moment of prayer as we prepare to respond by taking the Lord's Supper? Would you just bow your heads and would you just consider for a moment this process that you are called to work out your salvation? And maybe take a moment and just confess sins that you've places you know you have not been obedient, places you have not glorified God. But don't do that just so that you will feel guilty. Do that so you'll better understand and appreciate God's grace, so that you might be able to respond by a grace-empowered will to live for God. Would you ask God in these moments as we take the Lord's Supper to just help you better understand, better trust in his grace, that we might not just do an empty action here, but it will be a time of worship. It'll be a way of us remembering the sacrifice that Jesus has made so that we might lay down our lives and sacrifice to him. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the gospel, the word of life. God, help us hold firmly to it. God, we thank you for Jesus, for what he did on our behalf. And we thank you for what we do in these moments. As we eat this bread and as we drink this cup, God, and as we remember and as we proclaim, help it to grow in our faith of your grace. Help it, use it, God, in our lives to help us to work out our salvation and to shine as lights in this dark world. We thank you, for God, for your grace, and I pray that your grace would empower us to live for your glory, knowing that it is for our joy. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Well, if you're here with us and you're able to take the Lord's Supper with us, we have some who are going to help you have the elements if you don't already, but if you want to go ahead and take those. I want to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, where Paul gives the church in Corinth instructions about taking the Lord's Supper as we do today. It's not just a simple activity that we do, but it's a way to respond to what God has done. Starting in verse 23, Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Paul continues on, verse 25, he says, "In the same way, also he," meaning Jesus, "took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" And then Paul says what we've been talking about today, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
Let's stand together. The depths of me, love me to the core. Who controls the world I see, walks me through it all.
You can remain standing. I just want to thank you again for being here with us or joining us online for worship this morning. I want to just thank you for your continued engagement as we are doing things and continually trying to just follow best guidance and make changes as we need to as we meet here. And so I just thank you for your flexibility and continual involvement through all that. Also, thank you for your continued giving. You can always give online or here in person as you are able. It always is helpful for us as we continue to do ministry here in our church. Outside the walls of our church, your giving makes that possible. I just want to remind you that at 6 o'clock tonight, we're having an evening service. It's not something we do all the time here, but something just kind of special we want to do. And so if you want to join us, you don't have to sign up or register ahead of time. You can just show up. Our front doors will be open, and you can join us. Doors will open at 5:30, and you can come and be seated and join us for a worship at 6. Just a good time to fellowship with one another, continue in this day of worship. Also want to remind you that just this coming Saturday, we're going to have a family event through our kids' ministry. So if you haven't already, let us know that you're coming for that. It's going to be this Saturday, June 5th at 10 o'clock. Let Jessie know that you're coming by sending her an email so that we can save a place for you and that you can join us for that great event. In just a moment, we're going to sing the doxology together and be dismissed. But as we're dismissed, if you want more information about Foster the Bay, about how you can support, pray for, commit to helping foster care in our city, about how to support foster families, or maybe become a foster parent or family yourself, Samantha and Marcia are going to be up front with some resources that they'd love to make available for you. So I'd encourage you to come and to find out more about that and get plugged into that ministry. Well, let's close by singing praises to God.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son,
so much, worship team. We've got Amy on the piano today for the first time in forever, and it's so great. She said, please get me on there quickly, so we did. And thank you so much for choosing to worship together. Every Sunday we have a choice to make whether we're going to worship the Lord or not, and you chose to worship together. We're glad you came and joined us. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God, may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.